Hi everyone and welcome to this video. As macOS Sequoia has been released a few days ago, but unfortunately is not officially supported on a lot of still perfectly working Mac hardware, this video will cover how you can work around that and still run that latest macOS version on your system even if it's unsupported by Apple. Since a while now, Apple is releasing a new major version of macOS every year around this period. This also means that every year, the list of officially supported machines has some of its devices removed, and these are no longer able to upgrade or install to the newest version of macOS, at least not in a standard or supported way. I've been covering the process on how to still be able to run macOS versions that are not supported for quite a while now in previous videos, as you can see. And this one is not much different. Specifically for macOS Sequoia, not too much hardware support was dropped. Only two 13-inch MacBook Air models from 2018 and 2019 will no longer be able to install the latest version of macOS in comparison with Sonoma. Still, the list of supported devices lacks quite some unsupported models that only came out 5 to 6 years ago, and these machines, together with a lot of even older ones, are more than capable to run Sequoia. Fortunately, we have a relatively easy way to work around these limitations by using OpenCore as our bootloader. Doing so will allow you to trick an unmodified macOS installer in thinking it is running on supported hardware. And by using OpenCore Legacy Patcher, which doesn't only make it easy to build and install OpenCore, we can also overcome issues for hardware components that got their support removed in newer operating system versions by supplying missing drivers, extensions, or other types of patches and workarounds to fix this. Right before the release of Sequoia, the OpenCore Legacy Patcher or OCLP team released their 2.0.0 version of the tool. And if you look at which models they support for Sequoia, you can see that this list is quite a bit longer here. It looks like most of the Mac hardware from 2008 onwards seems to be able to run Sequoia by using OCLP, which I think is very good news. On the website of OCLP, you can find a very detailed list of the supported Mac models. As you can see, with some of these, there might be some specific issues or remarks. The two most common are either related to GPU support, where OCLP will apply a patch for non-metal GPUs, or similar for legacy metal hardware, which in practice doesn't really affect you much. The second common issue, lack of support for USB 1.1, might require a small workaround to overcome this. In short, starting from macOS Ventura, Apple removed the support for older host controllers. This means that when you are directly connecting a basic input device like a USB keyboard or mouse, it will no longer work on such controller. OCLP can patch this, but only after macOS has been installed. So that means that during the installation process, you might need to connect your keyboard and mouse through a USB 2.0 hub instead of directly to your machine. I covered this before on a video I did when installing macOS Ventura on my Mac Pro 5.1 and similar for Sonoma. I will put links in the description for these videos if you would be in that situation and need some more details. Now, enough of the talking actually. For this video, I'll be using my late 2014 Mac Mini. This device's last officially supported macOS version was macOS Monterey. And as we could already see, it is nowhere close to be part of the list of Apple-supported hardware for Sequoia. As a starting point, I did a clean installation of macOS Monterey, and in general, it is recommended to be on that last officially supported release of macOS for your machine as well. When we will be doing the installation of Sequoia, we should either be able to upgrade this or do a fresh installation. We will also need a USB drive of at least 32 GB for this process, and as a first step, we'll prepare this drive properly. Although OCLP should also be able to take care of this later as well, I prefer to make sure we start clean. So let us insert the USB drive first, and then we can start disk utility. In here, click on View, Show all devices, and find your USB drive on the left side. Make sure to click on the device itself, not the volume on the device, and then click on Erase. Provide a name. I chose Sequoia USB. Select macOS Extended as format, and GUID partition map as scheme. Then click Erase. That's all it takes. Our USB drive is ready now, and we can close disk utility and move to the next step, that is to download the latest release of OpenCore Legacy Patcher. Let's open up our browser and navigate to the website of OCLP. Then go to the GitHub page on the top here, and then two releases, which you can find on the right side. During the creation of this video, as you can see, version 2.0.1 just got released. If a newer release would be available, of course I would recommend to use that. Now, scroll down a bit and at the bottom of the release notes for this version, in the Assets section, download the OpenCore Patcher GUI.app.zip file. Once it is downloaded, go to your Downloads folder and start the application. Confirm you want to open it and enter your user's password to install some additional components when asked. In OpenCore Legacy Patcher, you can see that the model of this machine, Mac Mini 7.1, was automatically selected. The USB drive which we will be preparing will be model specific, so in case you would like to prepare a USB installer for a different machine than the one you're using to create it, go to Settings here and change the target model to the one of the machine you're creating the drive for. In our case, I'm creating the drive on the same machine as where I will be installing Sequoia, so we can just leave this as host model. The next step is to download the installation files for the new macOS version with OCLP. So let's click on Create macOS Installer, then Download macOS Installer. Make sure macOS Sequoia is selected in the list, then click Download. The download is roughly 14 to 15 GB in size, so this can take some time. But seeing how fast this goes, I must say that I'm pretty impressed. It looks like I'm able to make full use of my gigabit internet connection, and that less than a day after the release of this new macOS version, which means everyone is probably busy downloading this now. Once the installer is downloaded, it will still be verified and extracted, which again takes some time. When all of this is done, OCLP will ask us if we now want to use this downloaded installer to create a USB drive. Let's choose yes. Then pick the installer from the list which we just downloaded and choose for our USB drive in the next list. At this point, all data from the installer is being copied over to the USB drive. Once again, this might take a while, depending on the write speed of that drive, of course. After everything is copied, there is an integrity check on the data as well. All data is copied over and seems fine, so it's time to build and install OpenCore to that USB drive as well. Let's click yes here to continue. OpenCore gets built, which doesn't take a lot of time, and then we can install it to disk. Here, make sure to select the USB drive and not the internal drive of the machine, and select the EFI partition in the next step. Alright, at this point, the USB drive is completely prepared for our system. It has the installation files for macOS Sequoia, and OpenCore is installed on it as well. So, we now need to boot from that USB drive in order to launch the installation. As OCLP instructs here, let's reboot the system while we are holding down the Alt or Option key. By doing so, when booting, the system will show us the native Apple bootloader first. After a few seconds, the USB drive should appear as well, and now we have three options here. Left is our current installation of Monterey. The middle entry is to directly start the Sequoia installer, but this will of course not work as our system is not officially supported. And the third option is to boot OpenCore from the USB drive first. This is what we need to select. The next screen looks very similar as a native bootloader, but make no mistake, this is OpenCore instead. From here, we have the same current installation on the left and a second option to install macOS Sequoia. That is what we need, so let's select this one this time. After selecting it, this should now launch the Sequoia installer from that USB drive and you will eventually end up in recovery. There are several options now to proceed. Option 1 is to upgrade the current installation of macOS to Sequoia. In that case, we do not need disk utility, and we can just select the existing volume with Monterey in the next step. Option 2 and 3, to do a dual boot or a clean installation, both require disk utility, so let's go there first. In disk utility, let's go to View, then Show All Devices again, And in here, we can see both our USB drive and internal drive. If you would like to go for option 2, that is to create a dual boot installation, which means you will have both the current installed macOS version next to the new macOS Sequoia, select the internal drive and click on partition. Click the plus sign on the bottom here and then choose to add a partition. Next, you can resize a partition to divide the space between the two volumes and give the partition a proper name as well. Then click apply. I will not go for a dual boot, but instead I will go for option 3 and do a clean installation that uses the whole drive. In that case, make sure the internal drive is selected on the left side as well, and then we need to click erase, give the volume a name, choose for APFS as format and GUID as partition scheme. There we go. Our internal drive is prepared, so we can close disk utility and continue to install macOS Sequoia. Click continue to start the installation. Agree to the license agreement, and in here we need to select where to install Sequoia. So if you went for option 1 to upgrade and didn't go through disk utility, select your current volume here. If you went for option 2, the dual boot, make sure you select the newly created volume by using the name you gave it. And for option 3, which I will go for, we need to select the volume with the name which we just created with disk utility. And as you can probably guess, we're in for another bit of waiting time. At this stage, macOS will get installed on our Mac and files are being copied from the USB drive to the internal drive. If all goes well, and several reboots later, as soon as the installation is finished, you will end up with this initial setup dialog. In here, you simply need to run through the questions to configure things like your location, keyboard layout, create a user account, setting the time zone, and so on. Eventually, you'll be greeted by a Welcome to Mac banner, which is new, where we can click Continue and we get to see our macOS Sequoia desktop for the first time on our unsupported machine that is about 10 years old now. Pretty cool if you ask me. Although we got Sequoia running on here, we're not fully done yet. Right now, we are still booting the system by starting OpenCore from the USB drive. This means that if you would try to reboot without the USB drive in there, macOS will simply not start. So to fix this, as OCLP is actually telling us already by itself, we'll need to get OpenCore installed on our internal drive instead. So let's click OK here to continue. This will build OpenCore again, and then we also need to get it installed to disk, just as we saw before. In the dialog to select where to install OpenCore, we can see that we're currently using it from the USB drive, as we know, but this time we need to select our internal drive as destination instead. Once everything is copied to the right place, let's test if this worked as expected. Let me first eject the USB drive and remove it from our Mac Mini. Then we can proceed with the reboot. We can see the OpenCore bootloader briefly appearing, which is already a good sign, and it automatically continues to boot macOS, exactly as we would like to see. Looks like everything is working and we're able to boot macOS without the USB drive. That's good news. One last thing that is worth to check is to see if the OCLP root patches were correctly applied. As we've used OCLP to install macOS, there is a handy link to the tool created in your applications folder automatically. So let's launch it from here and click on Post Install Root Patch. As we can see here, all applicable patches already installed. This means that everything is exactly as we want it to be, and we can start to enjoy macOS Sequoia. Let's start by taking a look at About is Mac and About from the Settings application. We already knew about this, but nice to see another confirmation that we are indeed on Sequoia on this unsupported hardware. We also have the new Passwords app available, as you can see. And let me open Notes as well. This got some small improvements, But actually, I wanted to have two applications open to test the new window tiling or snapping feature, which seems to be working pretty fine. All in all, despite this being a relatively old and especially pretty bad performing Apple machine, even when it was new, performance seems to be pretty good. Applications and tools seem to open quickly, the graphics feel snappy, and overall, I don't feel any slowdown in comparison with older macOS versions on this hardware. That was it for the video. I hope this will help you to extend the life of your beloved Apple Mac hardware. If you have liked this video, I would appreciate a thumbs up. Let me know how this worked for you or if you have any questions in the comments, and make sure to subscribe if you like these kind of videos. Thanks again, and hope to see you back here soon.